everyone he meets, he stays a stranger. Ready every move he makes, another chance he takes. Odds are he won't live to see tomorrow. Secret agent man, secret agent man, they've given you a number and taken away your name.
When I was a young man growing up in New York City, I refused to pledge allegiance to the flag. Of course, I was sent to the principal's office, and he asked me, why don't you want to pledge allegiance? Everybody does. I said, everybody once believed the earth was flat, but that doesn't make it so. I explained that America owed everything it has to other cultures and other nations, and that I would rather pledge allegiance to the earth and everyone on it. Needless to say, it wasn't long before I left school entirely. And I set up a lab in my bedroom. There I began to learn about science and nature. I realized then that the universe is governed by laws and that the human being, along with society itself, was not exempt from these laws. Then came the crash of 1929, which began what we now call the Great Depression. I found it difficult to understand why millions were out of work, homeless, starving, while all the factories were sitting there. The resources were unchanged. It was then that I realized that the rules of the economic game were inherently invalid. Shortly after came World War II, where various nations took turns systematically destroying each other. I later calculated that all the destruction and wasted resources spent on that war could have easily provided for every human need on the planet. Since that time, I have watched humanity set the stage for its own extinction. I have watched as the precious finite resources are perpetually wasted and destroyed in the name of profit and free markets. I have watched the social values of society be reduced into a base artificiality of materialism and mindless consumption. And I have watched as the monetary powers control the political structure of supposedly free societies. I'm 94 years old now, and I'm afraid my disposition is the same as it was 75 years ago. This shit's got to go.
Hi, I'm Kerry Cassidy from Project Camelot, and we are here with Richard Allen Miller. He's a physicist and explorer of consciousness, and probably a master magician. Magus is what they call him. And
oh no!
Oh no!
I just hate it when you do that.
And I'm going to say that it probably in some ways you're kind of like the original Doctor Who. And
well, that's English. More like Doctor Strange.
And yeah. You're probably also maybe the Aleister Crowley of this.
No, I'm going to be part of a group of magicians that will try to show how, at this moment in time, changing lifestyles can be, you can use systems like magic. Magic's a higher form of physics. It's breaker, 1-7, come on. Can you imagine that in the 1800s? They wouldn't get it. Actually, in case we'll tangent here a minute, I personally think that we were visited in the 1850s, probably around the Carrington period, and there are now two societies that exist. That one has space travel and one that does not. I have seen top secret documents when I worked at Boeing indicating that we were off to Mars before we even thought about the moon. Moon didn't have any cheese. There was nothing there for us. Maybe there's secret bases. I don't know about that part.
Right.
I don't. But what I do know is it's a gravity well, and if you're going to do anything in space, satellites, system defense, whatever, you do it from L5 positions, not on the moon. And that moon costs money. There's nothing there to work with. Mars has water. In fact, I'm going to put it on my website, just a little visual so everybody gets it. Earth, moon, and right in the middle they have a little dot, and that's the amount of water that's on the Earth. And then, because of the recent landings, we now know how much water literally is on Mars, and that put that little dot there next to our dot, it's bigger. Mars is much smaller. It's a water planet. And
Here we are.
How many centuries and we've been thinking it's
correct me if I'm wrong, wasn't Mars a water planet?
Mythology and the asteroid belt and the blah blah blah.
You don't believe that it ended up to be almost a nuclear winter on Mars, the surface of Mars?
I don't know. I hadn't talked to them in my past lives there on that one, but I think there is a thing going on here that has nothing to do with Mars, because in fact, the studies I did with military, I saw planet Uranus. This was came out of cosmobiology. It was a Yugoslavian project, and I did a 360 at Boeing to try to capture, reproduce their data to see if it was configured right. And when the planet Uranus, this was the Department of Interior, Menlo Park, grant that gave to me, that when Uranus was in a certain position with the Earth and the Sun, there was a 3 sigma air coefficient of earthquakes. So then I had to ask, well, what is the storms on Jupiter mean? What does that mean? It's all in metaphor. And what is your metaphor of the circuit paradigm?
Okay.
Gregory Bates, that's the part where we have to look at things not spatially, okay, because it that's kind of an illusion of just certain senses. The body has other senses. We're now discovering how birds can flock and migrate because of pair coupling in their eye and being able to see the shifts of the gravity fields, okay, and they know where to fly.
Okay, well, what about the idea
that... Man has that too, by the way.
Yes.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, exactly. So what about the idea that you actually you're following a trajectory that's an inner trajectory?
That's correct. That there's something else going on here than the physical plane. We've missed the whole point of it.
In advance of coming here, so to speak.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't know. What I do know is...
Are you a precog?
I can do anything I want to do, and so can you. Teach people how
sure.
I got seals to do that.
I understand
But yeah.
But you yourself have done this. Right?
Oh, yeah. I won the contest. NASA canoe, Carl Wyszewski, Llewellyn, 1965, brought Gene Dixon and Sybil Leek and all these people in, record history, and they invited me in to show how the seals do it.
Right.
And I won it by 3 orders of magnitude type. Top psychic there. I won that psychic tournament.
Okay,
it wasn't about me. It wasn't about me. What?
Beyond Ingo Swan?
Ingo Swan was at that time still in Chicago. I don't remember if Ingo Swan was there or not.
Okay.
I know that there were several others.
How about Pat Price? Did you know Pat Price?
No, I don't know. I didn't know the people. I was a new...
Hal Puthoff, you went to SRI.
Hal Puthoff was older. I mean, younger. He was younger.
Uh-huh.
He was a younger generation. We're talking 1985.
Hal Puthoff's younger than you?
I don't know how old Hal Puthoff is. I thought that he was at SRI in the 80s, not the 70s.
True.
I was doing the 70s.
I see.
That's what I meant by I don't know how old he is. I worked with Tiller and Kuharich is who I worked with.
Okay.
You know,
Kuharich. You mentioned him a number of times.
Well, Kuharich was one of my teachers, and he was...
What about Uri Geller? Did you work with him?
Uri Geller was his protege, and I was the one that busted Uri Geller at SRI. I caught him cheating.
Really?
And it broke Kuharich, and Kuharich was my teacher. It's like someone I didn't want to bust him, because what had happened with... what's his face? Uri Geller was that Geller couldn't do it just at any given moment.
Sure.
He could do it.
Yes.
We measured that. We confirmed something's going on here. When he started cheating, for ladies and, you know, that kind of thing, where the ego is involved in cotton. Well, what took the whole data out the door is a baby with the bathwater. And that was the shame about that. That Kalugin, it was doing the same thing, moving things up, just moving across the thing. We had a magnet. You know, I remember the great Randy did a challenge, you know, because he didn't believe any of it, right? And you know what would be really interesting is to teach you this technique,
sure.
And then challenge his $1 million challenge where you can prove you can do paranormal, and once that takes care of him, and that takes care of the $1 million challenge. You can probably talk him into it for the media publicity. Right? The whole point would be, great, Randy's, you know, has this $1 million challenge. I'd love to see you go after him. I think that would be, because all you have to do is verify it with a team of science. Now, what that will really do, $1 million isn't important. It makes ESP, it makes ESP in the same category that hypnosis was when I was in the 70s. In the 70s, there was, Gil Boyne didn't exist, and there was no certification programs and those kinds of things. And now it's turned for ESP. And ESP isn't ESP, it's, you already know, it's just consciousness isn't the real deal. And you need to learn how to go to certain places that you can do things that you can't do here. And this place, you can blah, 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 blah. Okay.
Okay, well, we are all magicians, okay?
That is correct.
And I think that we would definitely agree on that. Now, what I want to do here is back you up. I want you to tell me, you know, we just had a conversation over lunch, okay?
Sure. We'll do
and
that.
We did a little preliminary.
You'll chew me up and I'll just flow.
But I would like to just hear a little bit about your early childhood.
Oh.
I don't want you to go into detail. Yeah. I don't want you getting the I want people to understand how really amazing you are. And so we're going to go step
I'm
by step.
I'm not.
You are amazing.
Guess what? You can easily, in this lifetime, be what I am if you want to do that.
Hey, we're both amazing.
I would want
How's
to do that?
That. You good? Okay, so we're all amazing. Humans are amazing. I see humanity as an amazing vehicle, okay?
Rudolph Steiner says we're devolving. What do you think of that?
Maybe some of us are.
Well, that's why we have Joseph Campbell that says when you see the kingdom of the Father on earth, the apocalypse has already occurred. It's perpetual. And so when you talk about past lives, it's called the net or new, that moment of nexus of that, by the way, that neurotransmitter you didn't talk about was like surgery gets an MI for Larry. He has alcohol and marijuana.
Okay, we're gonna go to Larry.
I got you, but I thought.
But let's, like that. Yeah, thank you.
You're
but
welcome.
Let's start at the very beginning. Okay.
I love it.
You were born in the Philippines.
No, I was born in Everett, Washington.
Okay, yeah.
I spent some time as a child in the Philippines, so I couldn't spell. I couldn't read English in fourth grade. I had a special teacher that then kept me after school and taught me how to read.
Okay.
In the fifth grade, in our local library, any book that had a little science fiction mark on it, I read it. I read it, blah, 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 you know, just consume that all. Then in sixth grade, I got a Chemcraft chemistry set. I was making pipe bombs when I was 12 years old.
But slow down. So you actually, your real father was not the man who raised you, right?
That is correct. I don't see my father. My father. My father's the one who gave me my humor.
Your real father or
no,
your real father?
My father.
Okay.
Yeah, my father gave me my humor, gave me my sense of rigor, gave me my sense of...
And he was a Navy man?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
But the man before, the one whose genes you have, so to speak, right?
You mean the Nelson one?
Yeah.
Lord Nelson?
Yeah.
Kill them all, let God sort it out. Really?
Okay.
Oh, no, that was earlier. Yeah.
Okay, but was your mother's line Nelson, or was it your father's line?
My mother's was
Nelson.
They came in on the Whitman trains.
Uh-huh. Do you know what your father's line was?
No, I don't. I've never...
Okay.
I've
but
got
it was
what
certainly,
I got.
Okay, it was pretty Anglo-Saxon.
with, right. I obviously got German, I've always got English, I've always
got the blue eyes,
Aryan,
which, the whole, thing. So because it matters, because I'm going to talk about that a little bit later, we're going to go around, we're going to circle back a little later.
Can I
broach the subject of what that like sort of someone would say sort of a crystallizing, catalyzing incident in which you were thrown in the oven as a very young child?
Missing time. You know, confabulation. Who knows?
We don't know.
I have memories.
Okay.
Are they real?
Did you have real memories?
My memory seems to be pretty good.
Well, would your mother remember this memory?
It happened, maybe not the way I remember it, you know, as a four-year-old.
But somehow you ended up in the oven and you got a lot of burns and you had
to
the hospital?
I don't know what happened.
Okay.
I know that then I remember when my mother introduced me.
So you had that incident. That may have affected you. It made you, so you were unique, you had a certain
armor,
kind of...
places in the brain, birthing. Yes, of course. That's Steve Gaskins and the farm, and his spiritual midwifery, and the way you're brought into the life, and what happens, presets certain belief systems, assumed truths,
but in a certain way, that's... I mean, it may not have been intentional like that, or maybe it was intentional, but there is an Illuminati torture element.
Illuminati is illuminated. It's just like they did in the movies. Illuminated, they were scientists they were the scientist part of the church.
Of the occult.
Okay, now. Of the Church of Rome.
All right.
The illuminated ones were the scientists for the church. And what happened over the years of Weishaupt and all of the early stuff, confabulation of memory. It isn't what happened, it's what you do right now that makes the moment.
Right.
And that's, it's not about the past. Right now...
Okay, but what I'm getting at here is that as a child, there's a certain catalyzing event that actually forces, it's kind of like if you take a bottle or whatever, a container, and you squeeze it, and then what's inside starts to come out. Are you with me?
You mean that toothpaste where sometimes you have to push it real hard and squeeze
whatever
it down?
Whatever you want to call it. That's kind of
I hate it when I do that.
This is what goes on.
Oh, that's
but okay.
Rod through your ear. And
from there, if we move forward.
Right.
At that point, what would you say is like the next major incident that you remember? Because I'm very curious.
I had a knee go out when I was 15.
You had what?
I had my knee break at age 15.
From what?
Football.
I see.
Right. I was an athlete.
You were?
And I regrew it back.
Okay. You did?
Yes, I did. Then I had it happened another time, and then I had an artificial, and now I can Argentine tango.
Okay. All right. So at some point, you kind of turned to science, right?
I was always science. I was always, I was at science club when I was in fourth grade. Even though I couldn't read English,
yeah.
I couldn't read.
So you had that liberty.
Yeah, four-year-old. That's the four-year-old that never becomes seven.
Why?
What does that mean? There's a mentat in terms of your wiring that changes from when you're age four to when you're age seven.
Right.
You go from eidetic imaging to a different way of brain storage.
Okay.
I never made that change.
You did.
But now I'm 68. Yeah, a little 68-year-old brat that, by divine right, has a sense of where we should go.
Okay. All right. So you won the science fair. What was that?
In 1960. That was my junior year in high school, Mount Rainier High School. I won the Navy Quizzer Awards, Army Awards, blah 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 awards. With a new meson field theory. And it included a new elementary particle called the muon that generated tachyons.
Did you say you built a linear accelerator?
That was the second year.
Oh.
Then I applied that thing by creating a linear accelerator, hydrogen bubble chamber, and created particles going faster than the speed of light. And that was 1961.
And you were still in high school, right?
Right. And I went to New York, and the National Science Fair.
Okay.
And I came in second. Guess who came in number one? Robert Strump, UNIVAC. And he, you know, it was Robert Strump from New York. And so, you know, there it is.
All right. So
I was always number two. Yeah, truly. And that was in my high school years. Then I went to Washington State University. I started at the UW.
But you said they had their eye on you, so to speak. Your father was in the Navy. You had
because I won all of these awards, right. I had the old man DuPont started orchestrating my education.
Did you know that for a fact?
No, not then. I know that now, yeah. You know, going back, having access. I did. The first inkling was in 1970 when I saw the three top secret documents. And the first one, I said that Mariner 1, flyby on Mars, discovered water on Mars using my protocols. Oh. And, you know, and that's when I realized. And then the second top secret document, they detonated a nuclear warhead on the South Pole of Mars and it didn't work.
Wow.
And I don't know. I just saw that a detonation had occurred as a form of terraforming. Oxygen, get it dropped. And you know what being on Mars would be like right now without it terraformed?
Tell me.
Okay, if you're standing on the surface, your feet are at 72 degrees, the air is so thin that you're at a -5 at the top of your head. That's how quickly the temperature changes on the planet Mars if it was 72 degrees. Now, it's 100 below zero, actually, Fahrenheit. And so, but we're scaling it, so to give you some idea, okay? And what we have just discovered is, below just 6 inches, the ball of water, it's a new form of structured water. It's structured water is deuterium, tritium, you know, for cold fusion processes. It's a new form of water that hasn't been described yet. Jerry Pollack was my lead. When I worked anesthesiology at the UW, and is now professor emeritus in the world on structured waters. He's the one that does that beaker where the water runs across that long distance, you know, he does that.
Okay.
You know, we understand things like how photosynthesis works. I mean, you know, when a photon of light hits that structured water,
right.
What happens is, Richard Feynman said, likes like. And the positive atoms go up here, and the negative atoms go down here, and you have a battery. And that's photosynthesis, and that's how it works. And when you put certain kinds of structure to the water because of deuterium, because of that is having a different isotope on it, then what happens is the structure of the water. Now, what makes water so important is that it's hydrogen and oxygen, number one and number six in the periodic chart. Helium has H2 is a stable molecule, but hydrogen and oxygen as water, as the smallest molecule, is a dimensional gate because of its dipole moment. And so it gives you the options of doing other things. That's why water is a really important resource.
And it is a dimensional gate.
It's mathematically is the way you would express that.
I see.
How
about the water on Mars then? If normal water is a dimensional gate, what do you think the water on Mars is capable of?
There you go.
It would be nice for you to answer that question, because
I bet it would. There you go. I don't know. You know, okay. I mean, I can.
But I have. I'm Project Camelot, and we have witnesses who have who worked in above top secret, who have said that Mars. I have been told by someone who is risking his life to tell me this information.
Well, I don't know about
Mars,
that. I know that.
I know you don't know about it, but I'm going to tell you what I know.
Okay, cool.
And you can
all
tell
right.
me what you think about what I told
Good
you.
Good luck.
Tell you He said that the Mars that we see, that the military is dealing with, is actually fourth dimensional Mars.
Isn't that amazing? Yeah.
Okay. And now you talk a lot about, well, we're getting off the touch.
Not really.
Okay.
I already went there. I did the math, you know, like.
Because you talk about the information.
I talked about Matty Pitkinen and Alex Kavarinen. Alex Kavarinen talks on structured waters. He's finished.
Right.
He's dead now. He was brilliant.
Okay.
Nobody's ever heard of him. Well, you know, some people have, but, you know, pretty sure of me. You know, that, well, that's the deal, say. You know,
okay,
you're rarefied.
Well, I'm going to describe kind of your trajectory, so I'm going to go back and we're going to
You're going to stop down and try to get that same hair in the same place.
No, we're just going to try to get, you know, because I know people listening
you know
want to follow.
You know what this is? Mudras for Chinese.
Okay. I want to follow you.
Yeah, it's a word of
Tai Chi. Because people want to understand who you are that's talking to them to some degree.
I see.
And it helps if you build a historical
I'm just
sort of
a nerd kid. I'm a scientist, you know.
All right.
And
but you're a lot more than that because you ended up making this very strange, you know, well, strange for certain scientists, kind of right turn into
Russia was doing it.
Yes,
you're really into it, man. I mean,
Russians
you know, Yugoslavia, for example, had some genius.
And I know you start your book out with the
Dr. Milan Rizal. Well, Dr. Milan Rizal, he was Czech. And he's still alive, and he's now at UC Davis.
Oh, really?
Yeah. You're welcome. I'd be happy to give you a phone. And you know,
he must be
the
very
great
old, though.
Randy.
Yes.
He's 83. And the great Randy, I'd like to take him down. I mean, not take him down. Not so much that. No, because he's actually valid. To show him the world, not him, the world. That the possibilities.
Yes.
Once that part is stepped, so it's not about money, it's not about taking someone down, it's not about that part of it. It's about that guy's moving forward. It's about, get a grip. You know? 400 years of monetary, it doesn't work. You know, time to move on, that's the word.
Yes.
Okay. How
okay,
did
and really, I want people to understand that the reason this man is here, okay, at this time, it's because they actually pushed him over the edge to such a degree that he ended up coming out, going from being, what, a farmer? You called yourself a farmer. You kind of...
Well, I'm an agricultural consultant. I, for the last 40 years, have been farming.
Okay.
I mean, small farming, you know, 40-acre field.
And we're not going to go down that road yet.
Okay, sure.
So at the moment...
40 years. Imagine what I know.
Okay, but we're still with you in high school. Okay.
Right.
So you've won all these science fairs and whatnot.
Yeah, well, they're just, you know, I got to go on the Sea Wolf to Hawaii.
Okay.
No, I did.
The Sea Wolf.
Flew me out, yeah.
Okay.
The Sea Wolf was brand new. It was a nuclear-powered submarine out of San Diego.
Okay.
I was, they flew us out of Sandpoint, Washington.
All right.
Yeah, PBY. Yeah, it was so cool. And I got to go, they eat really good. Navy eats really good. You have no idea. You know, you come to these big fancy hotels and they eat better than the Navy, trust me when I tell you that. I mean, they really do. That's the deal. When you're at war or at sea, at least you're going to have some of your...
I see.
There you go.
That's interesting. Okay. Well, look. So, at this point, how do you go from high school to college?
University of Washington, physics 121, they had 101 and 121. Physics 121 is for science majors and the 101 is for non-science. And the 121 is a hatchet course, you know, with big tidbits of about 400, 450 people. But at the University of Washington, and the second quarter, it was quarters, there'd be from 480 to 320, and then there would be 140, and there would be, you know, it's just, you know the rules.
It was like that.
And they had the John Dance lecture series going on. And because of that, both Richard Feynman and the guy that invented covalent bonding,
vitamin
C.
Linus
Pauling taught 121 and Richard Feynman taught basic chemistry, 121, 101, 121, okay. Then 122, 123, and then he went to second year. And I did 4 years of that intensity all the way up, and then went to the University of Delaware under R.D. Murray, Nobel Prize winner in solid state physics.
Okay.
And he sent me to places like MIT where I would do NORNAND logic using fluidic devices and Corning systems, okay. Object-oriented software writing. You know, the Actor 4.2 in your database is right now probably under accesses using 4.2 with ACT on top of it or something.
Okay, but what, so at this point you're moving through time. What exactly?
Isn't it cool?
So, hold on, at some point your path, you get into kind of working for the military though.
I've always been working for the military. In my undergraduate year at Pullman, I did an undergraduate thesis, which means I have a BS in physics in physics, not philosophy of physics, because I did an undergraduate thesis. What I built was a plasma jet that now Giannini uses in the space program to make space tiles. And I created a flame 60 times hotter than the surface of the sun. And they were afraid I was going to blow up the campus. It was really cool. You know, one of those.
So you work for the military. What part of the military? Are you at liberty to tell me?
Well,
were you Navy? Were you
Navy intelligence?
Were you ever Lawrence Livermore at Labs?
Yes.
Did you work for Teller at all?
No, Bill worked. Well, I'm not going to say he worked for me, he worked for Puharich, but I was MRU.
Okay,
what's MRU? That means Mankind Research Unlimited. I was Northwest Regional Director for Dr. Carl Schleicher. You don't know him?
Well, I know the name. But
yeah,
I'll
bet. Yeah, I was Northwest Regional Director. Bill Franklin was Midwest Director. He's out of Kent State, and he did all the work at University of Chicago. If anything weird happened on the West Coast, it was mine, to try to figure out what's going on. Sometimes I was not necessarily the lead. Do you understand what I'm saying?
No.
We would be part of the team, but not the lead of it.
I understand, okay. But if they had a problem, you actually told me, and people can appreciate this because the military is, or aspects of the military,
it's
kind of unique in allowing you to be sort of this person who kind of went in between the cracks. You didn't follow. You know,
they wanted me. It was back in the 70s. Yeah, back in the 70s, it was about blue sky. We didn't know where it was going to go.
Right.
It was in the 80s that it all changed into application.
Okay.
Leon Sidoroff has a thing called the Emergent Mind Bulletin, and she talks about remote viewing and the dangers of it over astral projection.
Right.
You know, we're scientists. We deal with certain kinds of things like radiation, like plutonium. Reactor 4. You know, the whole thing's nuts. And if people don't start to... There's nobody... I don't know what to do about the politics. I don't understand politics. I don't understand that thing.
Okay.
But even Ralph Nader isn't talking about Fukushima. What the...
Yeah.
I mean, what the... I mean, it's already, today... Just from leaking water in it, the bay is 287 times more radiation. And right now, the chatter is that, and it looks like it's all good to go, there are two major islands up in the Kamchatka Sea that Japan is buying from Russia. And how do you evacuate 40 million people out of the prefect? It doesn't, I mean, how do you do that?
Well, I've heard that some of them are going to come to
in
Australia,
our lifetime,
and some
in
of
our
them
lifetime.
Are going to China, and some are going to U.S.
In our lifetime, I think Japan will no longer exist as a continent. It's a terrible shame. The history and richness of their culture is, it's like Aztec horror. And it's happening right now with global weather changes.
Right.
And that's what we're about, the urban survival skills and how to...
Yes.
Avoid a zombie. Well, you know.
Okay, well, but speaking of that, we're talking about...
I did you have that, didn't I?
No, it's just one of our cameramen. Anyway, making me laugh here. So, but the bottom line here is, when you were we're still back in the military. You're working for the military.
By the way, I just did a little Kevin in here. The people that are actually going to make the change are 6 years old or younger. It will be no one else that actually causes the changes. It'll start at 6 years and younger. They're the ones that are going to do it.
Okay. Well, we might have a little difference.
I'm on record saying it. It's it's a fact.
I'm sure they may have to implement.
They're the ones that are going to take over the food thing. Or they're already doing. There's a girl that was 13 and a half 2 years ago that went to the United Nations, addressed the United Nations, and said, when I was your age, when you were my age, you didn't have to worry about the food you ate. You didn't have to worry about, you know, the air you breathe.
Right.
What have they done to us?
Sure.
Well, that's what I'm about.
Okay.
It's not about me. It's about...
I know, but we're telling your story right now. So to get back
here... You can throw that away.
You were working for the military from some aspect of
It started innocuously.
Okay.
I was in anesthesia. Started Boeing Company, actually.
Okay, so you're at Boeing.
I'm at Boeing. I come out of graduate school. I start to work at Boeing, and there are several projects going on. There was out of MASD is where I was starting, and I worked. I'm going to have to remember things. Art Pilgrim was doing Lunar Base Alpha 1 as a hydroponic system that later became New Galilee Gardens and some other things, but originally. They were doing studies of growing pot on the moon. There's an article about that, truly. They were doing the original studies of about six different plants in space, and to understand how the different light bands, at that time, we didn't know about cannabinoids. We didn't know about, we weren't into the herb chemistry on that level yet. We were just starting that part of it. Now we've got, toity-toity, there it is. But, Aaron Stevens is Jacobs. Aaron Jacobs runs the marijuana museum in Amsterdam, and his wife is the Sensi Seed Bank. And you talk about heirloom seed and what's going on now in the world with Microsoft. And it doesn't make any sense what they're doing. It's like...
Well, I might have a few...
I'm sure you do.
Okay, but let's go down this trajectory. At some point, you said you were called in to solve problems.
Yeah, if they couldn't figure it out, they would bring in the weird balls. They would try to make some sense of it. Mostly we didn't. Mostly it was like catching flies. You know, I've seen things that I have no idea what they mean. I mean,
can you give us an example?
Okay, a Sherpa, white feather shaman, walking up Mount Rainier barefoot. Jack Schwartz, being able to take a stick through his arm and not bleed, no pain.
Okay.
How does that work? Well, I figured out some of that. You know, some of it I figured out, mostly not. The shaman, it turns out the red feather shaman walks on coals up in Mount Vernon. Okay, we found a spot on the back of the back that is radiating heat. It's a form of electrophoresis. It's superconductivity through the skin. It's a headspace, again dealing with an altered state of consciousness. You can do something you can't do here.
Right.
That's what it's about.
Okay.
And that part...
But how did you make this transition? Because you were a physicist, a scientist, and you went into the area of consciousness. At what point in your trajectory did you make that sort of shift? Do you know?
There are a number of cathartic points, of course.
Okay.
Theosophical Society, discovering
how to grow. All right, so you got into math. Okay, how did you do that, though? How did you?
I went to the Theosophical Society of Open Form. Mm-hmm. And sitting here talking old leads, talking about Ledbetter and Eastern tradition.
Yeah.
Annie Besant, smoking your cigarettes.
And your mother was a psychic, right? You also left that out.
Yes, I left a lot of things out. Yes,
okay.
My mother and grandmother were so well known working with the Seattle Police Department that they did a TV series called One Step Beyond.
Okay.
Right. And it was about things that happened to them, but the way the series did it was different people and different, they did it that way. This was at the same time the Twilight Zone was on. Called One Step Beyond.
Okay.
And That's my mother and grandmother.
All right, so you had a background, sort of. You grew up with your mother, she had this ability, you must have had a similar ability growing up?
No, that's rhymed in 1950 when I'm a young kid.
Yeah.
They came through with the Foundation for the Study of Man, and they tested my sister and I.
And what happened?
They thought I was a fourth stage telepath, whatever that is.
I see.
I don't have a clue what that means. I was a young kid, I played with it a little bit, you know, you can feel it like something's watching you, you know, and it's aliens, you know. This is in the 60s, you know, early 50s,
sure.
Late 50s.
Well, come on, you must have watched Spielberg movies and, you know.
Oh, that's much later. I was out of duty.
Okay, so get back to where you are as far as... in that you're working for the Navy, you're making a transition.
It's Navy intelligence.
Navy intelligence.
Navy intelligence is different than Navy in that we're basically Jesuits for the Church of DuPont. He reported to Rockefeller. DuPont was mostly interested in the technology. That's what Navy did. We did it first, and then there would be a trickle down to Army or whatever. But it was always Navy that had the choice.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean,
and you know that the Stargate, that whole... it was called, where I'm talking about this came later. Remote viewing, and I asked
you. Yeah, that's in the 80s.
Okay.
We're doing something much weirder.
Are we in the 60s or 70s?
We're late 60s and early 70s.
Okay.
Late 60s, like 67, 68. That's when Yugoslavia was...
Jim Morrison, The Doors, talking Tavistock.
Did he die? Thomas Lytle. Secret and Suppressed. Feral Press. Can't get kidder.
You have heard of Peter LaBenda?
Yeah, Tom Lytle was my best friend. And Psychedelic Essays and Monographs. He died in Florida, you know, just 2 years ago. But and Neil Goldsmith, you know... you don't know New York
Post? Not a,
New York Poetry Science Talks and Omni Magazine.
What about Allen Ginsberg?
Yes.
You know,
Alan Watts.
How about
there
the...
You go. That's, I studied with Alan Watts.
You did?
Yes. And I...
For how long?
I taught with him at Cold Mountain Institute before he died. Okay, I was at Evergreen.
Yeah.
And he wanted a second kind of Buddhism, which is minus Chinese. Yeah. And actually, I'm not a Buddhist. I'm a magician. I'm like different, you know.
I get that. Okay.
Yeah.
So, but again, we're still trying to find that area where you kind of moved out of sort of science and got into the mind.
Meta means beyond.
All right.
Metaphysics is beyond physics.
Fine.
Worldview, you come down into...
were you disenchanted? Did you find a limitation in physics? I mean, what...
Well, it's emotions. Is something more going on here. Let's figure what that's about. What about those inner space things? Let's take a look around.
Okay, what can did you meet Leary?
I've met Timothy Leary.
I know you have, but was he the catalyst? I'm looking.
He's only one. The first catalyst was the woman in fourth grade that kept me after school and made me learn how to read. I did Freddy the Pig and Mrs. Pickle Goes to Mars. That's how I started reading.
Okay.
Gotcha. And from there, really.
Okay. But come on. I'm trying to figure out. You're in your 20s. Let's say you're in your 20s. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay. And you're working for the military, and you're doing these jobs, and you're reaching, you say you get given a puzzle or whatever, a problem to solve, because they can't solve
I'm in school.
You're in school.
Yeah,
okay,
when
school.
I'm
but then,
20.
But then you graduate, right?
And I graduated, and then I went to graduate school. I went to work at Instrument Products Division with DuPont in Newark, Delaware, and that's where I went.
But isn't DuPont paint? Come on, what are they dealing with?
The Experimental Research Station in Philadelphia had the most PhDs in the world in one spot.
What were they trying to do?
Okay, where I came up with the holographic universe, I was walking down the hall and I looked in, and here's Gabor, whatever way you care to pronounce it, Gabor, and he's creating a three-dimensional television, 1967, three-dimensional color television. Where is that? What happened to that? I saw it in 1967 and why I wrote the holographic concept of reality. That because I saw that and then realized what a hologram really is. At Evergreen, I wrote a movie, well, we were in the basement, the science people. They had a photography thing that won Best Picture of the Year, Cannes, called Eat the Sun. It was about a new religion based on biofeedback.
Okay.
And I have been writing this thing on using feedback systems so you can change consciousness. Okay. The idea of you're hallucinating, if you're so out of shape. You know, there's some aliens that think, how could we exist as a life form when the difference between being psychotic and normal is measured in micrograms? How does that work? You know, really, I mean, we're talking about some subtleties here now.
Okay, but at this point, you're working for DuPont. Where do you, when do you actually make the jump from DuPont into...
Okay, when I worked with DuPont, they sent me to graduate school. I finished graduate school and I came to work at Boeing. When Boeing had 50,000, you know, scientists hit the street all at one time because of the losing of the B-1, I had a job at Boeing still, and I gave it to my lead. He was a grade 14, way more years into it, so he took my job, and I started working at the UW, anesthesiology.
What's the UW?
University of Washington, Department of Medicine, School of Anesthesiology.
Okay, but why
fourth
did you do
floor.
Okay, what were you doing? What anesthesia? What was
the
that?
The outer or the inner? I had an outer show. I was creating an aortic catheter.
Okay.
You know, the single most important measurement in medicine.
Okay.
It goes in through the femoral artery, goes up into the aorta, and measures instantaneous cardiac output.
Okay, what
that's the bottom line.
What's the inner, what was the inner job? What were you
Korean doing? Photography, blah, 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 blah.
So
blah.
You were photographing
talking with plants, yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
you were doing experiments with that?
Yeah, we, video feedback. I had, at the UW, I had a book club. So I could, you know.
What?
A book club. Like
what's
an emu. Synthesizer, I could do all kinds of frequency bands. I could do any band I wanted. So I, you know, I was working like with, they had laboratories where you had toys, so
yes,
you could really do cutting edge. And I had toys, and I learned audio and video feedback systems at the University of Washington. They had security clearances into the vaults in the basement, just like Chicago did. You know, secret. You had to go in with a badge.
And I bet you got in there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, all the time.
Yeah.
I had crystals grown there.
You did?
Made, yeah, for the aortic
catheter.
Did
you find what? What other uses crystals have?
Solid state physics. Let me tell you. I was going to write rich, magical and ritual use of gemstones. And I never did. You know why?
Yeah.
There would be 14 chapters.
So,
each one for a broadest lattice.
That's that
Pythagoras.
Mean?
Yeah. Pythagoras says there's 14 ways matter folds in or out of itself. They're called broadest lattices. It's a mathematical thing. It has to do with octaves and matter.
Okay, so
right.
But you, I still don't get why you didn't write the book. Why didn't you write a book? You said you were going to write a book.
I've written more books than anybody in the world. Will you see what I'm going to do this year alone? You have no idea. Here it comes. You don't even know this. With the modern alchemist,
all right.
I have pantheon, archetypal gods, and daily living. Oh, keep you with that. 28 chapters, and then I have 12 more volumes called The Holistic Kabbalah. That's online also, and breaking
you know
down...
The Kabbalah isn't complete, though.
What's that?
It's not complete.
Well, are you talking about Doth and the missing Sephiroth in the middle of the abyss? I have that chapter on that one, too. And you're talking about the male and female going up. We go to God. The two paths are the hermit and the lovers, and what crosses them, humor. Zap.
Okay. Look, at a certain point, you ended up meeting Timothy Leary,
yeah,
and going and working for John C. Lilly. When were you, because weren't you younger?
Lilly's lab, what is Carl Sagan? Carl Sagan wanted to know if the Dalton language, the clicks and whistles, was formed. They wanted to know, is that a language?
Uh-huh.
And I had this thing for languages.
Yeah. You have a natural proclivity for languages, and so at
mathematics, yeah.
And when was this? Wasn't this when you were young?
No, let's see.
You told me it was like you were in high school.
No, not in high school.
You were 20s?
I tried to think it was more like 1968.
I know, but
69.
So you were...
Might have been 69. It might have been 69.
Were you in your 20s?
Yeah, I was working for Boeing. You know, I was already out of graduate school.
All right, and so
I was in four 30s.
You went down and you were a test subject to do what?
No, they brought me into his labs, and for about 10 days I took recordings trying to understand from the frequency bands what these different movements were. And I discovered that the format of the way they did with it, it's a form of Clifford algebra. Dimensional math, they're like 10 times more aware than Hebrew in the mother languages in encoding of information. They're a more highly evolved mammal than man is.
Did you talk to Stan Tenen about it?
I did mention to Stan, when I met him, I mentioned
and
that.
And how did he react?
They have a dolphin program there on Hawaii, but the one I did was in Key Largo. I did Dolphins Plus with Tom Little, you know, Tom Idle. And Tom, I was with Cosmo. I was 4 hours in Phoenix with the dolphin, and the trainer had, had the dolphins coming up to me, and I grabbed on each fin, and they pulled me through the water, right? The trainer didn't know this arm wasn't real. And that dolphin did. That was Cosmo. And he pulled me differently than the other one, so I was able to be pulled through the water. He was lighter on my thing and the joints.
I know, but did you communicate with these dolphins telepathically? How did you communicate?
I don't know how you do that. It's in their eye. Starshine. It's like when you do eyeball to eyeball and you all of a sudden, it happened. That's the soul part. The dolphin are there. I can't explain how to, happened with my dolphin. When I met the dolphin, I felt like I was in the presence of a real alien, and so much more to give to me. Some of those mammals are, they're open. They can leave anytime they want.
Right.
In other words, they're there because they want to be there.
They want to share.
They get them usually from shark or something that hit them, and they rehab it, and then the dolphin can leave if it wants to.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of times they don't. But then neither do kids leave McDonald's. So we got to be really careful what we're doing here. I thought I'd play with you on that one. That's the other part of all of those equations, is that we don't have a clue. And what we do, a wolf, timber wolf, is closer to spirit than man is. What a wolf does is not wrong. There's nothing it does that's wrong, because it's about instinct. Okay, that's the lower brain. The gut is convoluted, and the neurotransmitters, a lot of thinking from there. There's some metaphors going on in the body, just heart centers and other places. Call it triple warmer. I haven't figured out what a triple warmer is yet, but I did the early acupuncture studies at the University of Washington under John Benica. There were a group of scientists that were studying anesthesiology. They were studying the barefoot doctor's manual. I wanted to see, and we brought Dr. Chu, who was at that time China's leading acupuncturist, into the laboratory. And because I was working upstairs, I got infectious hepatitis working with blood. I built a jig. I was doing sonic studies, through blood attenuation studies.
I see.
But with crystals we use on the catheter. You knew blood, for example, is at 10 megahertz. That was already done. But aortic cotton walls, we needed a pulse echo thing going on. And what frequency then? And I was doing that study.
I see.
And I figured it out. There it is. Boom. And
okay, but
I lost my thought.
I know, but you were working on crystals and going into
crystals are metaphors, just like space time is.
Okay.
It's about the geometry of it.
Yes.
And when you use that geometry in your mind's eye, that's what I would have been in the ritual use of gemstones. Natural and ritual use of stones would be, you know, the Brahmas, lattices, Pythagoras. That's how I would write the book, you know, I mean, in terms of what I know about magic. It's about, that all comes, by the way, the concepts of that, Ezekiel's vision and the throne chariot of God. That's where Stan Tannen and all those people, you know, trying to see the super code inside the Kabbalah.
Yeah. Okay.
Crazy stuff. the word.
But I still want to get back to the when you were working with dolphins. They used you. Why did they use you specifically?
Who?
You.
I never figured that out. I never figured that out.
You don't know?
No.
So
I'm a real scientist. I'm like a real scientist.
So you'd be a scientist and a psychic. Is it four-stage psychic? Or
no, I'm not Mulder. I don't have I Want to Believe. I don't have Robert Anton Wilson tennis. I didn't say it. See how I am? I got that though.
Yeah, okay, but you're still not answering the question. I want to understand, I mean, John C. Lilly.
I was there 10 days, I did was I recorded the languages of the dolphins.
Yes. You recorded it.
Yeah, and they're talking to each other.
Anybody could record it. They don't need you to.
But they can't figure out what to call, in terms of, and what I would do is digitize certain things. This is before computers. We had a Wang, before this.
I understand.
Okay, good. And so, in fact, I didn't even get about computers. That was one of the areas I missed. When Robert Shrum beat me, he beat me, in a year back. When I went to Nationals, New York.
Yes.
Oh, I didn't tell you that. Wait, I thought I told you about New York, and I always was number two.
Okay.
I was never the best. When I went to New York, and they had the National Science Fairs, what happened was, I came in number two. I didn't come number one. The guy that beat me had UNIVAC, had the first. They were using relays. I'd never seen anything like that. I didn't know about the difference machine. I didn't have read Gibson. I hadn't done, all of those.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I hadn't done any of that.
Did you read Gibson?
Oh, yeah, of course. Von Bode was a personal friend of mine.
Let's talk about John Bohm. Is that it?
John Bohm. His implicate order, the concept of the implicate order.
But you were there before him, right? Is that what you were doing?
Right. We were doing holographic. We were suggesting biological processes. We were the first to suggest that the whole thing had to do with biological processes, not universe. We started looking at the body, what the body really is and what it isn't. The difference came out of Kerlian photography. When we realized Kerlian photography wasn't real, what we have discovered was bioluminescence and the concepts of what bioluminescence was really about. That was what I'd done my graduate work in.
Okay, and so explain bioluminescence to me.
Well,
in a way,
there are many forms of bioluminescence. There's the decay center luminescence, where your atom comes in, bang, and causes a defect in the lab.
Okay, but it contributes. You can make stealth, stealth technology.
That's now. Back then, it was the sports car that turned brown and you had to replace it, color centers. Light causing plastic to change color, for example, was the technology we were looking at. And so I was going to talk about dolphin again. On the dolphin language, the structures that came, what I did is I digitized and started looking for cadence things and mathematical relationships, and nobody else thought to do that, I guess. And that's when I discovered that the cadence systems that they were using was precisely like, I know Ahn's algebra, I know Clifford algebra, I know all kinds of dimensional maps, all these different forms. And what I wanted to do, that's what I did in there, is the first algebraic expression for consciousness. I have, actually in this book, I have how it works mathematically. See, once you get it in your mind's eye, my explanation doesn't matter. It's not about that. It's about your mind's eye and what your mind's eye can grasp. And then you start looking for the dimension of it. That's the part where you win the lottery. Or take on Greg Randy. If you could win the lottery, you could take on Greg Randy. Because you could take my course, win the lottery, that proves that. nice back cover thing, and then take on Great Randy, because that's exactly how it's probably going to work.
Okay.
Truthfully, you'll try it. You'll play, and you'll see.
What happened with Lily at that point? I mean, did at some point, they brought, you said you worked with
Well, that's when they went off on their studies of the dolphin, yeah.
They used you.
But that's all I did with that.
And then you went back to what, Boeing?
Yes. Yes, actually, anesthesiology. Boeing. I was still at Boeing, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay, so where did you go from there?
I went to all the places.
Point,
I mean, they sent me around.
Yes, I did.
And they sent me all over the place. I know. I saw
Antarctica
things.
You were in Antarctica. So.
I have been to Antarctica, yeah.
Okay, and what were you doing there?
That's another one. I saw, I don't know what I was doing there. That was one of the times when I wasn't the lead. I was just along for the ride kind of thing as a physicist that they brought in. You know, we saw artifacts. Now, when I say artifacts, I don't know that they're alien. Again, I suspect there's something else going on with civilizations, and I think that we had reverse technology in the 1860s, 1850s. We had contact back then, and I think that another culture that does have space travel now exists. They're us, you know, isn't like, you know, but they're...
Yes.
One that does and one that doesn't.
So you think they started in the 1860s? This is
1850s. Yeah. 1850s.
Incredible.
Yeah, I can show some argument, Carrington effects, and some other things that happened during then that telegraph them down. How's that work? Coronal mass ejections from the sun, like we're going to have right now.
Right.
Yeah, right now we're experiencing one that less than 3 weeks ago there was a coronal mass ejection from the sun that if it had been pointed at the Earth.
Sure.
But fried everything.
Okay.
Our grid would be down for 2-3 weeks. Imagine living 17 floors, is that where you were up here? And having no water or a place to go to the bathroom.
Sure.
Where would you do that, downstairs? It gets better and better. A zombie is East LA when they're out of food.
Sure.
And I don't think there's any infrastructure right now that exists for food less than 2.5 days. I would think, I saw Kailua one day after Fukushima. I couldn't believe it. The shelter ripped. They're gone. After Fukushima went through, they had a little earthquake. You know, they had a little quake that hit Kailua.
Oh, yeah.
About 3 feet.
I see.
Yeah. But just the fear of what was going to happen, they went to lower brain. And the shelf got ripped apart. The place looked, I have a video of it, it's wonderful. It'll be in one of my PowerPoints. It's a picture of, you know, about food, what are you going to do about food, you know, and then you got water and sanitation.
Okay, well that gets to the reason that we're having this discussion in part. But, you know, what's interesting is that, in many ways, you've been writing for Nexus for years, right? Nexus magazine.
Yeah, yeah.
And, and we have some mutual friends in Australia.
Good.
And cool. Have you ever been to, you know, to the...
Shall we mention his name?
No.
No.
We
should not, but,
the underground base?
No, he hasn't talked...
Have you ever been there?
You mean to Broom Lake?
No.
No, I haven't. I've been to Broom Lake.
You have?
Yeah. I did a stint there. We'll talk that on another time, and I'll save that just for you.
No. I'm here now.
Krill.
Krill?
Yeah. You don't know who Krill is?
I know the name. Can we elaborate a little more about Krill?
No, I'm going to leave it at that. That's where our first reminiscence of synthetic telepathy arrived and the Alan Frey's work and figuring out how do they communicate like this? You know, how does that work? You know,
so
that's
they
where.
You in to communicate.
I'm sorry.
Weren't you brought in to communicate?
No, I was requested for some other reason. There's some missing time. Truly, in the debriefing, yeah, it actually happened.
Okay.
And I'll talk about that later.
Okay.
I mean,
how much later?
When we're off camera, but I'll tell you what happened.
Absolutely.
You know,
okay.
I don't know what happened. Do you know when I? That's how it
All right,
works.
Let me tell you a story about Area 51. I know some military guys who were special forces, and just for
this
fun.
This is later, though.
This is later. They broke into Area 51. They went in through one of the air shafts.
There's stuff in Area 51 that is. I saw nanotechnology anymore.
Okay.
I mean, where does that come? That's creepy stuff.
Yes.
That's creepy stuff.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, what they saw was
smart
this
blood. I saw smart blood.
Smart blood.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, do you know about the Falklands War and the black oil?
No, but I've heard about it. I don't know that. I saw smart blood, and because I saw smart blood, you know, that's Greg Bear. Blood music. The sci-fi book, Blood Music?
No, I don't know that.
Absolutely, Greg Bear.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, wrote Blood Music.
All right.
The blood gets intelligent, decides it wants to talk to God. How does that work? It gets weird from there, man. Goes right over the edge.
Okay. Anyway, these guys discovered there was a ball floating. It was watching them. You heard about those balls?
Floaties. They're taking too much methamphetamine. No, I'm just kidding.
No, it's very real.
Yeah. There's a lot of things that are real.
Okay.
Wendigo, Bigfoot, you know, all of that kind of stuff, the Chupacabra, all the different forms that Skinwalker Ranch.
Come on, did you ever take
I would love to do Skinwalker Ranch. I would love to have some toys. And that's what I did. When
okay,
in the 70s, I did something like Skinwalker. Yeah, but that's what I did with paranormal.
Yeah.
When they would have something they didn't understand. Back then, they knew about aliens, but they were more worried about what the Russians were going to do. That's the way I remember it, honestly.
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, Yugoslavia had made strides in their researches that even today, I'm impressed with cosmobiology. The concepts of cosmobiology, interesting science.
I mean, what is cosmobiology?
Metaphors of celestial movements, so that it, like right now, the Earth's going through dragon tails. The dragon tails in deep space have actually pushed the reverse pole for almost 6 hours. It's on my website. It was a pole shift for about 6 hours. NASA recorded it.
Showed
it.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. March 11th. Yeah, there's this push. Backside of the Earth, we're back normal again. And what that was about, it's the Earth's dragging through cosmic streams of radiation.
Well, do you know who Paula Violette is?
No.
You don't?
No.
Okay, do you know about something called the superwave?
No, but I can imagine, you know.
Okay, well, it's energy coming at the Earth, possibly sort of like, if you can imagine a sort of earthquake in the galactic center, possibly, that sends out waves of energy that we are now encountering.
Harmonic waves. Well,
you wouldn't deny that we're
everything's
sort of
in resonance.
Encountering
okay, that's what I am.
As
a resonant physicist.
Yeah.
I'm not the quickening. All of that. The Earth is out in the rim, you know, where the center is a giant black hole. What do you think that might indicate?
Well, you tell me. You're the physicist.
Into the out of.
Okay, I
see. You wrote that book. It's after
May already. I see it's a gate. Well, and if you're looking at it like that, then I would see it as a portal into another dimension.
Not another dimension. That's the way Rod Steiger would into another dimension.
All right.
But it's
other
not dimension.
Other universes? Multiverses?
Well, possibilities is the word I would use. The possibilities. Because when you name it, you containerize it. And you have to realize that's really important.
Yes.
You know, because when you containerize it, you've already contaminated.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, you know, you heard about the two physicists who won the Nobel Prize for supposedly being able to isolate supposedly a particle, quantum physics wise.
Qubits, you know, where you put more information
and,
on less.
And then we're able to measure it without affecting it. I'm not sure if they really were successful at that, but
you're talking about
they're winning
the
prize
difference in Heisenberg and his uncertainty principle. I saw that article. I posted that article.
Okay.
On my blog.
And what do you think about it?
No. I could offer, I didn't. You know, I posted it as a gee whiz, you know, like I do. But I think you'll find that a holographic system will account for the data that they're discovering on this concept of a the way you enfold information so it folds out on itself, and space-time are really illusions. Lawrence Lashon, the medium, the mystic, and the physicist, it comes back to that. You wanted a key point?
All right.
Yeah, there it is. That's Kuparis' point.
I mean, just tell me in terms of, do you think the physicists that won this Nobel Prize can isolate a particle in such a way and measure it and then supposedly predict it, I think, was the next step. And then they were saying they could make supercomputers out of it and so on.
Yeah, that's the way it's about the way you array the information on itself.
You're the one investigator into consciousness. Wouldn't you say, how can you really eliminate our consciousness, in other words, our attention on something? Do you know what I'm saying?
I do it.
Without affecting it.
Okay. How,
we're going to affect it. If you can affect everything with the mind.
Exactly.
So there is no barrier there.
No,
right?
There isn't. No.
Even Ingo Swann was able to do this experiment at SRI where they have these layers of steel and they have this thing under, I don't forget what it's called, under the ground. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
And there he was able to change it. They wanted to know if he could affect it, and he did.
Dr. Hirishi Motoyama did it in Japan, where he put someone in a Faraday cage.
Okay.
And they had a one-on-one. That's one of the studies I did with someone outside the Faraday cage to affect his consciousness. Now, how could you do that? Except possibly in a quantum mechanical universe, unless you're using microwave. And so the body is radiating energies in a number of points. Those are called nadi points. Okay?
Okay.
You have your chakra points, and you have the places where you secrete oils, on your body. And these are places that are radiating part of the non-local mind, where your body's up here, just like your brain is up here.
Sure.
Except for, the hierarchy of brains.
Well, what about out of body? We're not even going there.
We can.
I've got,
because that's Monroe and the original studies.
Yes. Did you go to the Monroe Institute?
No. I worked with Robert Monroe when he was in California.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And
you two must have been. I would like to be a fly on the wall.
It was a wonderful thing back then. I mean, to meet these people and actually, as a scientist, a real scientist,
yes.
Measuring the fact that it's what they're saying is real. How does that work? How does that work? And what we're only doing is just now having models that will account for the data.
Right.
And the fact is, there's six space, seventh space, and eighth space, and imagine, we're in fourth grade. While one of us might run faster on the playground, we're all in fourth grade.
Sure.
Don't have a clue what's going on. I'm just aware that it isn't what I'm sensing. That's, as a scientist, I can prove it.
Yeah.
Now, if that's true, then what are the possibilities? That's what your wormhole is. The possibilities.
Okay. Let's talk about the I call it the secret space program.
Secret space program. That's pretty cool. I always wanted, my bucket list did include Mars.
It did?
You did.
But you never got there.
I'm going to be the Mr. Wizard that smokes the pipe.
Okay, what does that mean?
It means that I'd like to be Mr. Wizard and talk to the children about Mars. That's what it means.
Okay.
Because it's going to be the children that save everything. It's going to be the only ones that have not been contaminated yet.
Okay.
The educational systems are in shambles.
Yes.
It's an embarrassment.
Yeah, sure.
And
but did
there's
you,
no
did
reason
ever
for
occur
that.
To you that maybe they're beyond educational systems? Sure.
It used to be they'd say that it'd take 10% to change the world. Now they're saying it's 5%.
Really?
Yeah. Really? Really? Just start it up. That's my great-grandfather, when he said to Rudolf Steiner,
oh, right.
We are no longer at war in the physical world. If you want to change the world, you change yourself and the world changes with you. And that's, you know, path working. Yeah. The first steps. Keep a diary.
Yeah.
Keep a diary.
Okay, but just, okay, so, and that's beautiful. But the thing is that your father taught Rudolf Steiner, isn't this
no,
way? What are you saying?
Great grandfather. Rudolf Steiner's teacher, his lodge master.
Uh-huh.
And he's the one that decided that the lodge was no longer war in the physical world.
Was no longer what?
At war with the world on the physical level. That if you wanted to change things, you're not going to do it on the physical level.
Okay, but come on. Let's look at mind control. Let's look at population elimination. If anything, they're at war against us.
Well, who's them and us?
Well, who is? You tell me.
I don't know. I'm one of the nerds in one of those laboratories up there with his mouth open catching flies. I don't have a clue. No, I have ideas, but I'm a scientist, and I will always. To you, I promise you, my word, magician's word, that I'll always try to wear the science hat, you know, so that
okay.
From the science point of view, I'll tell you what I know. And that part, there is something else going on. It's not what any of us have probably discussed.
Okay. Well, let me, okay, you told me if you go into, where was it that you said you would go? You would walk into, I don't know, OTO, where?
Oh, when I walked into Amsterdam, for example, I have, you know, and I have a couple of buttons on my thing, right? And it's buzzing, started, I think there were 800 people here. It's because I had an OTO badge.
Yes.
And the other one was certified hypnotherapist. Who cares what? You know, just, you know, trying to keep it from looking all black. You know, little color here, a little jewelry there. But it's about the divine right. Magic is a higher form of physics. It has been reserved for the ultra elite of Europe for centuries through history.
Yes.
And you recognize each other, and that's that. I mean, you know, it's a darshan, eyeball to eyeball. That's a variety of notion.
Right.
And everybody should be doing it now.
But they have to understand there's a stigma attached to it. You understand?
That's the risk when you do shortcuts. Mm-hmm. You know, trying to take a shortcut through the woods. You have the risks of the shortcuts. You know, like addiction and you know spousal abuse or gambling or. Ooh, whatever. You know,
right, or sacrifice.
Sacrifice.
You know, blood sacrifice, blood addiction, all of that.
I don't know anything about blood sacrifice. It's about voodoo. When voodoo, if you want to talk about magic, voodoo just can get this emotional thing. Blood burning all over it. Tantric yoga. Sex magic. It was OTO's original thing. Make holy. A mass of the Holy Ghost. Consume the Eucharist. You know, that's the whole part of it. I know the rituals down to the point of precision on it. And it all is about thought forms. When you use the larger brain, what happens is it's full of logic, so it's going to play a chess game.
But it's all metaphor.
Well, isn't that interesting? Yeah, I wonder where that could go.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, and you understand that. But it is interesting because people will wonder, you know, they're going to say, but look at how you are. Look at who you are. You're really kind of clued in on certain levels, and people like you.
I don't know that.
Wait. Get targeted. Now, right before you got here, I was told you had three businesses that they attacked, and
oh
took,
yeah,
and
well, synchronicity and serendipity, artificial.
Is there such a thing? You know, in other words, it's not an accident.
How
there
about
are
this
no
one?
Accidents.
How about that? Okay, how about this one? Same mentat, third verse. Everything happens for a reason. Everything happens leads to something better.
All right, so and here you are.
Even though this happened to me,
yes.
What it's doing is allowing me to finish more than 360 books in agriculture. This week alone, Lenny has edited the 5-book series called The Encyclopedia of Alternative Agriculture for Urban and Semi-Rural Communities. Imagine that one. It's 5 books.
Okay.
Dig in. Set up little kibbutzim all over the place. Can you imagine? Mm-hmm. And you barter. Because if you barter, you take food out of the monetary system, they can't regulate it or call it a terrorism thing. And you barter for it. And everybody can eat their environment. It makes sense that this universe can see gardening as a God-given right, and it's a recreational sport like soccer. It's a lot of work, and there's ego involved with marijuana. My plant and my bud, and big buds. My plants right now are over 12 feet tall.
We talked about this. We talked about how marijuana attacks the will, right? Certain other.
What do you mean by attack? You mean it does it on its own?
I don't know. You tell me.
Well,
how does it
what
work?
Does on its own mean? Bad robber? Or you're the bad robber and it's not about the drug?
But it's about what you did to yourself.
We're talking about
uneducated users.
In ritual, when you put it in a ritual,
right.
Now it's a celebration of myth. And you can choose the mythology, pathwording, tarot, you choose the particular path, and you celebrate the myth by doing the ritual.
Right. Okay.
Absence. Would you like to try? I did that. 3-hour absence and
LSD,
get into your cups.
We're the same thing. Alcohol, we were talking about caffeine. All these things being used, and I just want to reiterate.
Ritual and have you take that one.
I want to reiterate through this information, though.
Huh?
For people, because, you off camera, we talked about this, and I just want you to reiterate what you said, which is that the notion that these things can be used for good or for ill.
It's not about Christianity. It's a living color.
Yeah.
It's not black and white. It's not about preferences over absolutes.
Uh-huh.
It's not about binary over triary. That tri-system, base 3, doesn't have any primes. The only reason you got base 10 is for the exponential.
Okay.
R squared
law. I'm not sure everybody's... Okay, you might be speaking in another language for something.
No, it's not. You all get it.
Okay.
Once you've got it, it's the depth of it, just like hypnosis, that becomes significant. Sleep now.
Okay, let's talk about that experiment.
I'm having too much fun. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
No, I'm like a little kid, so you can make me do naughty things. I'm really like a little kid.
I get it. You're very open. You're very accessible. It's all good. It's a beautiful thing. Now, what I want to talk about right before, during lunch, at the end of lunch, you told me this thing about the cone and the line, the guy that.
Okay. For the last, since the 70s, I harvest pine cones.
Yes.
The tree drops the pine cones. They're a fire hazard. The pine cones are used in wreathing. They're used as fire starter. They soak them in oil. Blah blah blah. In previous years, I would sell between 100 and 150 truckloads, just of ponderosa. There was a 53 highboys, a lot of cones. And the Forest Service gets a pound of flesh for the brush permit. Labor gets paid, they make about $150 a day in back-breaking labor. It's a seasonal thing, it's before and after the rains.
Okay, but that's not what I was talking about.
Yeah, they.
That's
they
how you made your money.
That's correct. And for the last 2 years, there has been an act of God in agriculture. Now, normally a tree will put out cones every year, except 1 in 7. They don't put out a cone. That was last year. And because of the drought last year, this year is the first year in history that there weren't any cones either. That's two
wow.
years in a row with
yeah.
no incomes. Well, that happened at this very moment that I was required to close down a business that I've been doing for 6.5 years. And I'm in negotiations for what they call a no-prejudiced statement, so I will be very clear in saying that I have come to live to see the day when alternative health has gone the way of big pharma. It's an embarrassment, but the two happened at the same time. Caused me to have to hustle and do a workshop, kind of thing.
Besides that,
that's a good thing.
In a certain sense, the Navy wants you and Max Matt Stein, we actually
started talking about that. I don't know that it's Navy.
You don't know it's Navy?
No.
Okay, so and it's
it
somebody.
May not be anything. It may be an alien. Well,
sure.
It could be a lot of different things.
It could be a lot of
pivoting,
things,
yeah. Yeah, for the Earth.
Yeah.
That's right.
But it's at a certain juncture that you're coming forward again, right? In a much more public way.
Well, this is 68. I mean, you know, how many more miles do I have? So there it is.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, Norm Shirley's 80. And
but
he would be like, I would like
me,
to be him when I'm 80.
Okay,
he's
but
very
you
healthy.
Told me 4 years ago they started to monitor you. They put
I had someone at one time 4 years ago come into my house, unhook my Linux router, go straight into my computer, and I didn't notice that it was unhooked for almost 2 months. After that, cameras went in because they wanted to know who it was. My guess is probably just someone wanting my cone business, which was very lucrative until 2 years ago.
Okay, but this is very superficial. I see a lot different than
I know you do, and it's a conspiracy thing or not, and you may never know.
Oh, well.
You may never know. There are many things I don't know yet. Do you understand? I mean, you
all
may
right, you
never
want to,
know.
You want to stay open.
Well, you have to.
Yeah.
You can't make assumptions, because if you do, then you're no longer a physicist.
I understand.
That's correct. And
okay.
So you may never know.
All right.
And so that's why.
Talk about Timothy Leary. How did you meet
yes,
him?
Well, but I'd like to finish this.
All right.
I think they need to put a mystery school in physics. Let me go further on that. How about cybernetic anthropology with Laughlin, D'Aquila, and McManus? And how about the idea of a thumb with fire as a form of technology possible over a dolphin that uses sonar for cold fusion processes?
Why are you saying this over that?
Because it limits what you can do in the physical world. Belief systems and values or would enrich you, Christianity, whatever, and limit you.
Sure.
If you were a Christian and two aliens walked in the door, well, you know what, the bleep would suggest that you wouldn't see them. Mm-hmm. That the ships on the horizon, that the Indians had no conception of being able to see a ship as a concept, mm-hmm. So they didn't see it.
Sure.
Subworlds with qubit information as all part of the stew. And you have to be open to the possibilities, and the limitations of it.
Sure.
Universes are always invented. In graduate school, undergraduate school, they had a thing called modern physics, usually your junior year. And then you do mathematical physics in your senior year. And in junior year, modern physics is dealing with, you know, nuclear energy and those kinds of things, nuclear reactions.
Okay, but
okay.
What about, okay, for example, what about the notions that dolphins use sonar through water, right? That's
yes.
The medium.
That because the medium that they're in, sound is more effective, because what's so special about water? It doesn't compress. It is the only thing that as it gets colder does not compress, it expands. Water only, dimensional gate, H2O, Kerry rings, H709 with a free radical ion, all the different forms of Willard water. You know,
okay.
They're all structured water.
Well, what I want to ask you is, though, that this out here, this space, this stuff that we call, that was called ether in the 1900s.
I'm well aware of it. It's good. You're tired, and I'm sorry, but that's
no. But you hear what I'm saying?
Okay, go ahead and do it again.
Okay, I just want to know what it, because you talk about the information field.
Right.
And I'm thinking, what moves through this space, through this, in other words, what
memes,
are you talking
about? It's called memes.
You think
physical, emotional, intellectual, there are 8 of them, there are octaves of 7 and an octave, just, there's 8 memes, they're geometric, specific to specific neurotransmitters.
Okay.
And there are different levels. This one turns this gate on, this one turns that gate on. You learn how to use that biochemistry, and you become a superman.
Okay, but I'm just throwing this out to you.
With training.
I'm throwing this
out. That was the word off.
What dolphins do with sonar can be done through this air.
Because sound, when it's going through water, the water doesn't compress. It won't distort.
Okay, but what is this air, what it does it do when it goes through air?
Well, air compresses, and so you have, Doppler effect for meow. You have the variation of the sound bite. Meow. That has a certain thing that gates certain neurotransmitters in your brain.
Okay, we'll talk about the signal now locality. You call it, but you don't agree, you don't kind of agree with that idea of signal.
I call it the non-local mind.
Okay, and
there's something more here that is part of the physical plane, emotional, intellectual, archetypal. There is a body, etheric, if you will.
Right.
Yeah.
But still, if you're, if you have somebody, let's say a person in Japan and a person here, and they communicate, right?
Okay.
So how's that taking place in the world of physics?
Intentionality. It's purpose. The purpose of it. It's all about intentionality when you talk to someone from Japan and there is a breakdown in the communication thing, you go to Avram Moles. He's a French mathematician. It's called aesthetic perception and information theory, and they talk about redundancy coefficient in terms of trying to communicate, if you catch my drift, where you're using idiomatic expressions and automatopoeias.
No, I'm talking telepathy.
What exactly do you think telepathy is?
Mind-to-mind connection.
How about, I would suggest something, a possibility of something a little different.
Sure.
Okay. How about, let me think about this for one second. Mind. How about the information is already in your body because it's not about space-time. It's about the way you are storing memory. Mm-hmm. Memory, the way Robert Ornstein would call it, is a duration of consciousness. It's the way you have two brains and a new adult. So the way the memory gets stored gives you a sense of time. It's an illusion in terms of the information itself.
So in other words, you're communicating with somebody in Japan right now by virtue of the idea that time doesn't exist, and
well, there's the numinous element. There is the numinous element. There is the part above yourself. There's the self, and then there's God. Self-realization. That's correct. But there's a hierarchy. There's an ontology of those mystical states. Mm-hmm. That's John Curtis Gowan. And that's in my second book, by the way. The first book, what I do, this is important. What I'm trying to do is understand each one of these altered states. Like, here is where you can do ESP. Okay. Once that gets cataloged, now you have some power tools to go to the second level, which is the power tools book, in using the information that you've learned on how to use these altered states. You can change your sex with neurotransmitters. Just, your preference. You can do that with neurotransmitters. And you can do that by imaging in your mind's eye.
Sure.
It's a ritual tool.
But this is also where mind control is aimed.
Well, I start off my first paper on what the new directions of mind control are, and I ask the question of what the mind is first. Before you can control it, you better have a definition of what you're dealing with, right? So, okay, what is it? There's the part that's knowable, there's dreams, there's blah, you can start listing a series of categories.
Well, some people say that the mind is a computer.
That's
all you do. That's just the interface.
Well, that might be the physical plane, then there's emotional. You might start with a computer.
Well, call it spirit, call it soul, whatever.
Soul and spirit within matter.
Use of the matter.
The stag, the unicorn,
that we call
the
mind.
It is all about the mind. The mind and body are part of something more.
But that's the interface. See, we would. I would look at it to some degree, if you want to say the holographic universe.
Yes.
Where, or even a virtual reality, let's say, because we think of it in these days, is you would go in and you would be an avatar in a computer game. In a sense, this is the avatar in this computer game.
It's the level of information. It's called the resolution of the information in a holographic system. And so at one level, it's a game theory. It works like game theory.
Yeah.
But there are other levels of the map. And with those are the possibilities. And that's the part that's exciting for me, the possibilities of what the mind's capable of.
Okay.
Well, I need a break too.
We're going to have to take a break, and we'll see where we're at.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I'm stale right now.
You're doing a great job.
Yeah, but I'm not.
We'll come
they're
back.
Little, we'll, they're snippets.
We'll come back.
Yeah.
Okay.
I know when I'm on.
So tomorrow we'll come back to this. All right.
Because Alan Watts was one of my teachers also, and I'm going to try to bring some of his extremely important concepts in. You know, he said, for example, this is a thing for you to contemplate, that, you know, the little pollen that we were looking at, we're going to make spring out of it?
Yes.
He says if you touch it twice in the same day, then a moment of infinite bliss occurs. It only lasts for a moment, and you forget it. Sleep now.
Okay. All right, we're going to try to pick this up at another point. I want to thank you for spending some time with me.
So I try to go and journey where the diamond crescent's glowing, and run across the valley beneath the sacred mountain, and wander through the forest where the trees have leaves of prisms and break the light in colors that no one knows the names of. When it's time, I'll go and wait beside a legendary fountain till I see your form reflected in its clear and jeweled waters. And if you think I'm ready, you may lead me to the chasm where the rivers of our vision flow into one another. White cascading water, she may beg, she may plead, she may argue with her logic and mention all the things I lose that really have no value. In the end, she will surely know I